Don McCullin, welcome to our studio.
Thank you.
This is a picture of Palmyra.
Yes.
Why did you want to go back into this really dangerous war zone?
I didn't consider the danger, even though when you drive to Palmyra, the ISIS are only 6 or 7 kilometres from the main road, and they occasionally cut the road. Naturally, I didn't want to be kneeling in the jumpsuit as a television kind of image of, you know, me being beheaded. But it's in my blood. It's what I've done for the last 60 years.
And you've done it better than almost anybody. And obviously, one of the most iconic pictures that you've taken of war, among the many wars you've covered, is the soldier stare in Vietnam. Mm. And that's that picture there. After all these years and knowing what an impact that one image had during the war, what does that image say to you today?
Well, first of all, let me be perfectly honest. I'm sick and tired of looking at it, really, because what it does, it cancels out every other thing you've done that came before it. Many of my pictures before, particularly this battle in Vietnam during the Tet Offensive, I've got some really powerful pictures of sacrifice by the American soldiers, you know, dying, and not only the American soldiers, but pictures of the Vietnamese who also paid an enormous price to eventually acquire their freedom.
You talk about the Vietnamese. Very few people, very few Westerners anyway, talk about the Vietnamese, and all the great war photography was mostly the American soldiers and Marines. But you felt very deeply about the huge cost of life on the other side.
As in all the wars I've covered, I've actually had a much greater concern about civilians, because they're always the last people to know what's going to befall them. And secondly, they have no one to help them when it does hit them, you know, whereas the military, you've always got, as you can see in this photograph, people who are going to carry you away, to medevac you away to safety and medicine. But the civilians, you see them totally lost and dumped and, you know, forgotten.
You were shocked when you got there and saw what real war is. We're going back decades now.
Yes. When I saw the price of war, which is totally unacceptable, and the pain and the suffering and that horrendous wounds. And then I, of course, eventually got around to seeing massacres and murders in front of me, things I couldn't stop.
And things you couldn't get rid of. Do these things still stay with you, the images, the thoughts, the feelings?
I've managed to chase away a lot of them over the years. There are one or two that still remain. And I've tried to cure my kind of my dark periods. I've never really sought any help, because I always thought I'll deal with it myself. And I do that by doing, I photograph the English landscape where I live in Somerset.
It is, I mean, the polar opposite to what we just saw. How did you fall into that, and what has it done for your soul?
Well, you know, over the years, because I was married and my first wife died very young, and, you know, my father died when I was young, I'm not without my own, you know, my own list of, or category of, you know, sad moments in my life. And I thought that by standing in the landscape, which is ever shrinking, the landscape in England is under huge threat, you know, development and solar panels and windmills, all the things I really hate. I thought to myself, this could almost be another war in itself, the war of, you know, of conservation of the landscape.
And there was I thinking that you got solace from the beauty and the light, but for you it's just another battlefront.
Well, I did get solace from the beginning, but then I started, you know, thinking, there must be a better purpose me doing this. Even though it was giving me a great joy and helping to cleanse my dark side, I started to turn it into a kind of struggle, you know, and putting all the economic factors involved and mixing it all up. And then, of course, I started getting angry once again. So it wasn't doing me any good in the end. So
how dark was your dark side?
If you came away from some of the earlier tragedies of the Biafran War, and some of the wars in Africa and the AIDS things I photographed, there wasn't enough darkness you could describe even. I would, you know, I'd walk into a school in Biafra and I would see 800 children dying. And as soon as they saw the white man coming, you could see, they thought there was some hope at the end of the tunnel. And what did I bring them? I brought them 2 Nikon cameras around my neck. And I saw these children dropping down and dying in front of me. And, you know, we live in a world now where the media isn't that particularly interested in the real tragedy in our lives.
Do you feel that?
I'm convinced it is, yeah. And it's also, you've only got to look at your newspapers today, and all you see is what I personally would describe as narcissism, really.
You started in Finsbury in London.
Yeah.
How old were you when you first took up a camera and took these pictures?
These are the boys I went to school with, actually.
Really?
Yeah,
they were a gang, right?
They were a gang of boys I went to school
with. Called the Governors.
They're called the Governors. I took this in 1958, actually, but, you know, in that time in London, particularly in the London area, it was a very tribal area, you know. You wouldn't go there, they wouldn't come here. And the interesting thing about this picture, everybody mentions it, is the fact they're all wearing suits and ties, which is almost absurd, really. The boy with the cigarette in his mouth later spent several years in prison for armed robbery. So, I mean, I could have been one of those boys. And amazing to think that the day I took that picture, my whole life changed. I didn't seek to become a photographer. It seemed as if it's sought me out.
Let's go back to one of your very, very early pictures, the picture of these boys with their little cameras on an outing outside Buckingham Palace. This is innocence. This is a completely different humanity that you found there in Vietnam.
What was sweet about it was there all of them got these little plastic cameras, and it's their sandals, which no boy of that age would wear today, and above all, those terrible trousers, which I used to wear as well. So everything about this picture is a sweetness, really. And I took this in 1961, I think, and little did I realise what was going to come after my pictures turned from sweetness to tragedy.
Just a year later, you took this picture. It was during the Cuban Missile Crisis. It really is stunning. I mean, I don't know, the power of one man or one person to protest.
Well, he was protesting, I suppose, against the American blockade. I mean, we were all alarmed that, you know, we were looking at World War III.
Is there an image that you're most proud of or that you love the most? You said you hated the one that's become iconic, but is there something that you love equally?
Well, I love the contribution that I'm making towards the English landscape. I don't want to leave this world with the wrong reputation. I want to leave behind, you know, I want people to think, well, he tried. He tried to do this, he tried to do that. But, you know, the war thing, I'm not proud of it. And the laurels that have come with it sit very uneasily upon my head. I have prizes that are in my garden shed. I find it difficult to feel rewarded at the cost of other people's suffering. So it's uncomfortable.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. I would just simply say in response that because you showed people suffering, it made a difference and perhaps helped end or change certain realities on the ground.
I wish I could agree with you, because I feel, and this is very sincere on my part, I feel that I haven't made any change or difference. Every year there's a new terrible conflict.
But imagine if people like you weren't there, it would be much worse.
If we hide things and we don't bring them out in the open, we'll never know. And if we don't know, it means that people will go on suffering. It's not right.
It's not right. Don McCullin, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.